Did we do last time? So we started from a Figama module D. So this is a Figama module of the OE. Which means that it either is either torsion or torsion free. And then we define some modules, D cross QP, which contains D sharp cross QP, containing D natural cross QP. And inside here, I had the set of elements which were 0 at infinity, which could be obtained directly from D by tensoring by the ring OE tilde. And inside here, I had D tilde plus. And on everything here, I have an action of the mirabolic. Okay, so that's the first thing. So what is important is that the functor D goes to D sharp cross QP. This one is exact. And the second thing is that this one is not so far from this one. Namely, if you have D sharp cross QP, and you mod out by D natural cross QP, then this is isomorphic to D sharp modulo D natural. And this one is a finite, finitely generated OL module. Means it's finite length if D is irreducible of dimension bigger than 2. Yeah, so that's basically it. And then we also defined a pairing, which goes from D cross D chesh cross QP with compact support. And the last thing I had was that for any open subset U in QP, I had defined a sub module D cross U inside D cross QP. And the residue map restriction to U, a restriction map restriction to U going from D cross QP to D cross U. And then I could define things which are compact supported, being the union of these things. So U is a compact open here. And so I have this pairing with compact support. And it goes to L mod OL or to OL, depending whether you are torsion or torsion free. And this pairing has a nice property of being P of QP equivariant. So you have GX, GY, which is equal to xy for all g in the mirabolic. And the last thing, in this pairing, what you have is that d chesh cross v is orthogonal to D cross U if U intersected with V is the empty set. And so you get from this that D chesh cross Q is in fact is naturally the dual, is a topological dual of D cross U. So you have some kind of, yes? Somewhat? Yeah, there is an orthogonal. Sorry. No, it's in the other direction. I just mean that if I take an element here, then I get 0. I should have said it this way, it would have been much better. And so finally, something that you get is that this Dietzsche natural cos QP, this one is the dual, the topological dual of d tilde mod d tilde plus. And if in the case of OE, what you get here is a measures. So this would be measures on QP with value in OL, so bound. And this one would be continuous functions on QP with value in OL, and which goes to zero at infinity. OK, so that's the object I introduced last time. And one thing I started to introduce was some analytic. So I mean, everything here is purely algebraic, basically. And so I was starting to introduce some analytic operation on these phi gamma modules. And so the statement that I had explained how to prove last time was the following. So if you have a phi gamma module like this, and if you have f from u to v, local diffeomorphisms, so local just means that f prime of 0 does not vanish. F prime does not vanish. Nowhere. If you take an element z in D cross U, then you can define F star Z in D cross V by the following formula. So F star Z, so it's a horrible formula. It's a limit when n goes to infinity of some for E in U mod P to the n. Of f prime of I, f of I, 0, 1, rep p to the n zp of 1 minus I, 0, 1, I, z, sorry. And I remind you that this rep p to the n zp is the map that I, sorry, it's not rep, it's res. So it's a restriction map that I defined here. And so what I did not have time to state is the following. So what is clear is that this f star that we define is continuous and OL linear. That's no problem. I mean, it's not clear to prove that it exists, but to prove that it is continuous and linear is obvious. And what is more important is that it composes the way you think. So namely, if you have f going from u to v, and you have g going from v to w, so this would be three open compact, then you can look at G composed with F that goes from U to W. And if you take its lower star, then you get G star composed with F star. So that's not very difficult to prove, in fact. OK, so that was a direct image by a local diffeomorphism. OK, so now, and yeah, maybe I remind you how you get to this formula. It's always the same thing. You imagine that Z is a measure on ZP, and you try to, I mean, you have natural F star in this case, and you just translate the formula that you get for this F star in terms of Figama modules. Yeah, yeah, they're always compact open here. Okay, so now let's say I have now I want to multiply by a continuous functions. So I still have a U which is a compact open, and I take a function alpha which is a continuous function on U with value in OL, and I want to multiply an element of Z in D cross U by alpha. So I define multiplication by alpha of Z to be the following limit. So it's the limit of when n goes to infinity of I in U mod p to the n of alpha of I, the restriction to I plus p to the n zp z. So it's clear that if you start from a measure, you're going to multiply the measure by the function alpha. So what you prove quite easily is that this m alpha is well defined. So this one is really easy if there is nothing to do, basically. In fact, what you prove is that this sequence not only converges, but if your d is torsion, then it is constant after some point. So it does not depend on anything. It's just because your alpha is going to be locally constant. But so what do you have? So in this way, you define a map m alpha, which goes from d cross u to d cross u. And you can prove the following properties, which are exactly the one you would expect if you look, if you think in terms of measures. So these properties are the following. So imagine you have two alpha beta continuous functions. Well, if you compose m alpha with m beta, you get m times the the multiplication by alpha beta. Something which is a little bit more complicated to prove. So is what happens when you have an f going from u to v. So it's a local diffeomorphism, and you have an alpha, a continuous function. So I have to take it on v. And you want to compare m alpha compose with f lower star. So you multiply by alpha after having applied f lower star. And what you get is that it is just f lower star multiplied, which you apply to the multiplication by alpha composed with f. Okay, and so one particular case of this is the following. So the restriction to an open subset U prime is just a multiplication by the characteristic function of U prime. Okay, and so you can apply this formula, and you obtain that the restriction to f of u prime composed with f lower star is f lower star composed with the restriction to u prime. So just applying the previous formula to the characteristic function of u prime. And the multiplication by m alpha just commutes with u prime. So you get that m alpha composed with restriction of u prime is equal to restriction of u prime composed with m alpha. That's just this formula here. Okay. And now there is something which is I find rather miraculous. So it's these things works well with duality. Namely, you have the following proposition. So the first one is relatively trivial. So first you take a continuous function, but which is invertible. So with value in OL star instead of OL. Yeah?
But in that last problem
that
you wrote, this is now alpha continuous function
coupled
to
positive
value, or you just extend by
zero? Yeah, okay. You can always multiply alpha by the characteristic function of one of u prime. And okay. So you take an alpha which is in a continuous function, and you take so you take some x in let's take it x in d chesh cross u, y in d cross u. Then what you find is that when you take the pairing I just recalled here, you have that the multiplication by alpha of x, multiplication by alpha minus 1 of y, qp, this is equal to x, y, qp. So this is basically trivial when you go back to the definition, this one. The second one is a little bit less trivial, is that if you take f from u to v to be a diffeomorphism, and not only a local diffeomorphism, so you want f to be invertible, then you have that f star x, f star y, qp is equal to xy qp. So maybe I explain how this works, because I find it a little bit, miraculous. M alpha x y, yes, you do. Without supposing invertible. So how does the prof goes? Well, you have that. I did not erase the formula. So you have f star of z, which is given by this formula here. Okay. So maybe I just write it again. So it's a limit, and you have a sum of I of f prime of I f of I 0 1. Restriction p to the n zp of something. Okay, so now this element here, where does it belong? Well, this is in p to with support on p to the n zp, and so this is going to be an element in d or d chesh, depending on which one you are going. But it has support in f of I plus p to the n f prime of I zp. Okay. And now, because you assume that f is a diffeomorphism, and because your open set are compact, this set are mutually disjoint, and they cover your whole f. Well, they cover the whole of V if n is big enough. So these are mutually disjoint. If n is big enough. And so now, because you have this orthogonality, it means that when you take the pairing f star x, f star y, then it is going to be the limit. And you can put, instead of having a big double sum, you just are going to have a simple sum because all the other terms are going to vanish. So it's a limit for sum over I of same pairing, f prime of I, f of I, 0, 1, times the restriction p to the n zp of 1 minus I, 0, 1, z, x, sorry. And the same thing with y. And now you just use the fact that your pairing is G equivariant. So because it is G equivariant, you can remove that. And now once you have removed that, you use the fact that the restriction to p to the n zp when you compose it to 1 minus I 0 1 is just the same thing as 1 minus I 0 1 composed with the restriction to I plus p to the n zp. Okay. And so now you have still something which is in G that you can remove. And so in the end, what you get the sum over I of the restriction to I plus p to the n zp of x, restriction to I plus p to the n zp of y. And this, by the same argument as before, is exactly x, y. So in fact, it's not a limit. It's true at every step that that this formula. So I find it. I mean, I don't know. I could not believe this would be true. To tell the truth. Which one this?
Yes, for the trivial case D equals OE.
Ah, for the trivial case D equals OE? I'm not sure. Well, this pairing is just the integration over QP in that case.
Yes.
Yeah, it's just the integration over QP. Yeah, so it's an extension of function by measures, so there is some mess, and functions do not interact. So, and I agree that in this case these formula are clearly true, but but still I was very surprised to. Function and measure interact. Functions do not interact with functions. And measures do not interact with measures, I mean, as long as you are interested in periodic integration. So anyway, this works, and it is very nice. Okay, so I think basically I'm done. And I can start speaking of the big paper. So what I'm going to say now, you can find in asterisk 330, and which is going to be phi gamma modules, phi gamma module, sorry, et représentation de GL2 de QP. So we are going to construct the periodic local Langlands correspondence. So we are going to go in the other direction. That's what I explained in my first talk here, where I gave a summary. So in my first talk, and that's also what Matthew recalled yesterday, I constructed the functor going from representation of GL2 of QP to representation Galois representations. Okay. And what I want to do is to go in the other way, because otherwise the description is too indirect and you cannot prove anything with it. I mean, it's nice to know that it exists, but if you want something precise, then you cannot use this description. So what are the objects? So what do we want? So we start from a representation of dimension 2, and we are going to, so V is of dimension 2. And we want to construct the pi of V. And we are not going to do that. We are going to use the fact that we know that V is the same as D, and we are in fact going to construct a pi of D. Okay, but first I define precisely what kind of object we want. So G is going to be the group GL2 of QP. And what follows? And so we have three categories of representation. So you have the torsion representation of G, which are going to be smooth OL of G modules. So smooth means that the action of G is locally constant. So every vector has an open stabilizer. And so we ask them to be with a central character. So this central character we are going to call, so these modules are always going to be called pi. Central character is going to be called omega pi, and maybe delta pi if I, well, I want to call it omega pi, but it's not impossible that some delta pi are going to show up. So this omega pi is going to be, so it's unitary, so it's something that goes from G to, it goes from QP star to OL star. And if I write it in this way, it's not uniquely determined because my thing is torsion. So it's. Torsion. It will be a consequence of what I write later. Okay. So this omega pi is not uniquely determined. So which is such that A 0 0 A V is equal to omega pi of A V. And this omega pi is not uniquely determined. So torsion means that it is finite length. Over OL of G. Yeah, and one important condition is that it should be admissible. So admissible just means that if you take pi and you look at a fixed point by any open compact, then this is finite length over OL. And in fact, this last condition is a consequence of the rest. So this is condition of the fact that that it's finite length over OL, central character, and the classification of irreducible representations. So this is a consequence of the other conditions. It's only for GL2 of QP. And so this relies on classification of irreducibles of reptors. So maybe I just recall you what they are. So I mean, Matthew recalled them yesterday, but I will change the notation as usual. So among this, I mean, one way of constructing representation of G is to look at induced representation from a Borel. So what I define representation B delta 1 delta 2. Delta 1 and delta 2 are two characters from QP star to the residue field KL. And I define B delta 1 delta 2 to be the induced representation from the Borel to the whole group of the character. So you have to take delta 2 tensor delta 1 multiplied by omega minus 1. So this omega is is x minus x mod p. So omega of x is x minus x modulo of x.
Which way do you put your Borel?
Yeah, okay. So my Borel is the upper triangular Borel. And so, yeah, so maybe I should tell you what the delta 2 tensor. Well, let's say if I have two characters, chi1 and tensor chi2, of a matrix A, B, 0, D, then this is the character chi1 of A, chi2 of D. Okay, so I put this normalization so that the non-trivial extension that Matthew mentioned yesterday is between B of delta 1, delta 2, and B of delta 2, delta 1. And so this one is irreducible. So B delta 1, delta 2 is irreducible, except except in one case. And the case is when these two characters are equal. So if delta 1 is not equal to delta 2 omega. And in the case where they are equal, so if delta 1 equals delta 2 omega, then you have an exact sequence like this. So you can twist by the central character, and then you are inducing the trivial representation. So you have the so you get locally constant function on P1. And in there, you have the trivial, the constant function, which gives you a one-dimensional representation. So we have delta 2. So this is a character. Delta 2 composed with a determinant goes to B of, delta 1, delta 2, omega, delta 2. And then you have the Steinberg representation as a quotient. What? Delta 2, delta 2, thanks. No. Delta 2, omega, delta 2. So the Steinberg. So I mean, this is set up also so that the functor V that I defined sends B of delta 1, delta 2 to the character delta 1. So as an aparte. So V is the character, the functor I defined in my first talk. Then what you get is a representation KL of delta 1, where delta 1 is interpreted as a character of the Galois group via using local class field theory. Okay. Yeah, and then here you have Steinberg tensor determinant delta 2 composed with determinant goes to 0. And so this Steinberg is irreducible. where Steinberg is reducible, and all its Swiss, of course. And finally, you have things which are not of this shape, and they are called supersingulars. And what is very specific to GL2 of QP is that there are finitely many of them. This is completely false for GL2 of F. So, finitely many of them. So this is false for GL2 of F if F is an extension of QP of degree bigger than 1, strictly bigger than 1. Okay, and I mean these supersingular, they act in bijection. So if you look at my functor V of pi, it gives a bijection between these ones and irreducible two-dimensional representation of mod p of GL2 of Galois. So it gives a bijection. With two-dimensional KL representations of Galois, GQP. Okay, so that's torsion objects. And now, I mean, the torsion objects are nice. But they are mainly a tool. Admissible.
You expect it's true more than
Well, this I'm not sure. I think maybe Florian has more ideas. No? I know that Enyar tried to prove it, but I'm not sure he also tried to prove that admissible implies there exists a central character. I'm not sure this is true either. This isn't.
So I thought he proved it for GL2.
Maybe he proved it, I don't remember, because sometimes he told me that he could prove that irreducible plus admissible implies that there is a central character. Is it? I thought it was not. Well, I don't know. So you discuss with Guy and you tell me whether it's obvious or not. I know that I discuss with him 2 or 3 times, and sometimes he says that he can prove it, and sometimes he says he cannot. And so so I don't remember where it stopped. So. Well, I mean, it should follow from some kind of Schur's lemma, but I'm not completely sure you can. I mean. Okay. So let's not go on. So I mean, my representation have a central character, and they are admissible, and the same as finite lengths, thanks to this classification, which is over there. So now. The ones which are more interesting to us are the OL representations. So they are going to be OL torsion-free modules. Irreducible. Yeah. So I always, I mean, in my well, L is finite but algebraically closed. Okay, so something like that. So, so I mean, I allow myself in my head to change when I say irreducible, I always mean absolutely irreducible. Otherwise, it's going to be little bit false, everything. Yeah, it's absolutely reducible. But you don't want to go to QP bar because QP bar is not so good to do periodic analysis. So. That might be not enough, no. For some, I mean, for this, yes, but for everything, no. I mean, usually you just need to take a quadratic extension, but but sometimes, no. Okay, so what are these objects? So you take OL torsion-free G modules. And so they are also called pi. And so what you want of them is that pi is separated and complete for a periodic topology. So it's a project. It's isomorphic to its periodic completion. And that each of these are objects in the previous category. Rep tors of G for all K. Okay, so when you go to the limit, of course, the action of G is not smooth anymore, it's just continuous. And so, and you have, you also have a central character because the central character are going to match to each other by force. And finally, the rep L of G is just a set of L tensor OL pi 0, let's say, with pi 0 in rep OL of G. So you actually ask most of the time that you have a Banach, and it is given to you with lattice, which is invariant by G. Anyway, that's the way they will be constructed. I know, but the morphisms are not going to up to some isogeny.
Yes.
Yes. I think it's basically automatic because you mod p, you have finite length, so there are not infinitely many things you can do. So. Okay, so what are we going to do? Yeah, and so maybe I should. So these are, as I say, unitary. Unitary because there is a lattice which is invariant. Admissible because of this condition here. But this condition, so this is by Schneider and Teitelbaum, there is a nice way to describe it by looking at the dual. So it means that if you look at the topological dual, then it is going to be finitely generated over, well, you start from OL double bracket K. So you start from any open compact subset. Here, you take the Iwasawa algebra, so the completed group algebra, and then you invert P. So admissible, yeah, and unitary, I guess. Yeah. These two things are also equivalent to that. So the Schneider-Teitelbaum characterization. So what are we going to do? So the aim is the following. No, So Schneider and Teitelbaum made some kind of foundational work on representation of PID groups, I mean PID representation of PID groups, and they came up with this notion of admissibility, which makes sense for any group. Okay, so what we are going to do is the following. So we are going to start with any figure module D, any character delta from QP star to OL star. And we are going to produce from this something that I called D cross delta P1. So an object with an action of G. And delta will be the central character with the action. Object with central character delta. Okay, so, well, whatever you start with. So in fact, the construction works exactly the same way whether you are torsion, not torsion free, or even over L. That's the same formula apply. So when you get to these points and you're a little bit scared, because it makes no sense at all. And so I was completely sure this was not going to work. I mean, the problem is that you start from things of arbitrary dimension, any delta, and you get a representation of GL2 of QP. So it's clear that something is wrong somewhere. So what is wrong is the following, is that if you look at the topological type of this object, so topologically, this object is not an object that you want. It's not a Banach space. So it's not a Banach space. And why is it not a Banach space? It's because it's a module over OE, let's say. I mean, it's not Banach type. because it's a module over OE. And this OE, I remind you, is an extension of a Banach space and by a dual of a Banach space. So this is Banach type. Okay, so it's, this is dual of Banach type. Okay, and so topologically, you have exactly the same structure here. It's extension of Banach by dual of Banach. And so the main problem is that this extension does not respect the action, is not respected by the action of G in general. So what will happen is that in dimension 2, so if D is dimension 2 and delta is well chosen, so delta has to be equal to the character which I call omega d. And omega d is just x norm x minus 1 times the determinant of d applied to x. So determinant of d is, so it's a Figama module of rank 1. So it corresponds to a Galois representation of dimension 1. And because it corresponds to a Galois representation of dimension 1, by local class field theory, it gives you a character. Okay. So in that case, you have an exact sequence. So you will get an exact sequence like this. 0 goes to some representation pi of d dual twisted by this character omega d goes to d cross p1 goes to pi of d goes to 0, and this is the pi of d you're looking for. And in general, so I mean this object exists, but I think it has no meaning somehow. In fact, Pascunas proved, I mean no, he did not prove that, but from what he proved, you can prove that there is no such decomposition, for example. For example, if D is dimension 3 and irreducible, then there is no such decomposition. So maybe I put it here, Pascunas implies that if D is of dimension bigger than 3 and irreducible, there is no such decomposition. Which is good. Okay, so how do you do that?
If you take, same.
Pascunas says the same thing. If you take a different character in dimension 2 and D is irreducible, then it's the same. There is no such splitting. You have to take this precise character. It just means an exact sequence which is respected by G. So that's what I mean. What I mean is that there is a sub thing, okay, a closed sub thing, which is of dual of Banach type, compact. Okay, so I mean the idea as always, so I'm not going to write the formulas, but the idea is to look at formulas for specific representations. So you start from a character delta and you define a representation. So pi of delta is a set of phi from QP. So it's some kind of induced representation. In fact, it's an induced representation. So it's phi from QP to OL, which are continuous. And you want that at infinity it behaves well. So you want that delta of x, phi of 1 over x, is also continuous at 0. I don't mean anything in a torsion case. So, I mean that if you look, if you tensored with a reduced U field, is dimension 2. That's what I would mean. Okay. So you start from this, and on this you have a natural action of GL2 of QP. So I'll just write the right action because the formula is nicer. A, B, C, D. Of x, that should be delta of cx plus d times phi of ax plus b over cx plus d. So this defines an action of GL2 of QP. And now you can try to look at the action, describe the dual, pi of delta star. Okay? So pi of delta star, if you take an element in the dual, well, you can define two measures on ZP by looking at the restriction to ZP or the restriction to ZP when you apply W. So you define mu1 to be the restriction to ZP of mu, and mu2 to be the restriction to ZP of 0, 1, 1, 0, mu. And there you get two two measures on ZP. And what do they have to do, these measures? They have to agree on ZP star. Because you start from something on P1, QP plus condition at infinity. And so what is the condition? Well, you're supposed to have the restriction to Zp star of mu 2, which is going to be some operator W delta times the restriction to Zp star of mu 1. And what is this W delta? Well, it is defined by the integral over Zp star of phi W delta of mu, of lambda, let's say, to be equal to the integral over Zp star of delta of x, phi 1 over x, lambda. Okay, and in this way, what you get is an isomorphism pi of delta star isomorphic to something that I will call d0 of zp with value in OL cross p1 delta, and by which I mean exactly the set of mu1 and mu2 which satisfy this condition, satisfying mu. No, I wanted to act on the left, but I mean, I hate the formula that you get when you put it on the left. So so the group always acts on the right, and so the action is always the same. Okay, so well, it makes me make a lot of mistakes to do these things in this way, but I don't know. I like this formula because it reminds me of modular forms. And so basically, what are we going to do? We are just going to replace d0 of zpol by any d. So replace. By d, where d is going to be anything. So maybe I will make a pause now. And so this is going to use all the analytic construction I put on my d, which are going to mimic this w of delta. And in fact, they are also going to mimic. So you have an action of g on this thing. And so it's a little bit perverse to write down something which is natural, meaning the action of g on something which acts on p1 by imposing a chart on p1. So that's basically what I'm doing. I'm imposing the chart of the covering with these two zp. And so it's very perverse to write the formulas in this chart, but that's precisely what we are going to do. So I have to tell you that you get horrible formulas, and you never use them, except to prove that this object exists. But to prove a real statement about it, you don't use them. So that's one good thing. Okay, so let's have a break. Okay, so it seems that everybody is here, so I will start again. I hope so. Okay, so what are we going to do? So now we start from any d, as I said. So I take an element g, a, b, c, d in GL2 of QP, and I take any u which does not contain minus d over c. And I define some function alpha g of x on u.
Does not contain,
yeah, thanks. So I define alpha g on U to be by alpha g of x equals delta of cx plus d. And this delta is the character that I mentioned before. Delta being a character from QP star to OL star. And so, as I explained, I have a multiplication map M alpha G going from D cross U to D cross U. And I also have a G star going from D cross U to D cross GU. And here this G is just the usual action of GL2 of QP on P1. Okay, so A, B, C, D, you see, usual action on P1, namely A, B, C, GX equals AX plus B over CX plus D. And because of my hypothesis, here you don't meet infinity. And so I can compose these two things, and I define HG to be just the multiplication. So in which sense do you have to do the computation? So it's G star, G lower star, composed with the multiplication by alpha G. And then there is a lemma, which is just an obvious computation if you use the formulas which are here, which tells you that this composes the way you want. So lemma, you have that H G1 G2 is the composition H G1 composes H G2. So you want, I mean, in order for this to make sense, you have to be sure that you don't meet infinity anywhere. Okay. And then, so that's the first thing. And the second thing is that, which is also a consequence of this formula here, is that if you take the restriction, then the restriction to U of composed with HG is the same thing as HG composed with the restriction to G minus 1 U. Okay, so when I have said that, then the definition of D cross P1 is quite clear. So first I define W delta from D cross ZP star to D cross ZP star. So maybe I remind you that this D cross ZP star is just D psi equals 0. And to be the restriction, so it's a restriction of HW. Where W is always this element of the viral group 0, 1, 1, 0. And so, well, you have an explicit formula for W. Well, maybe I put it. So it's a limit from when n goes to plus infinity of some I mod p to the n of delta of I minus I to the minus 2, I minus 1, 0, 1, times the restriction to p to the n zp of 1 minus I, 0, 1, z. So, I mean, you never use this formula, but what I want to point out is that if instead of having one Figaro module, you have a family of Figaro module, and if you have an element z which varies analytically in this family, then this expression also varies analytically. So that's what I want to point out, is that this formula makes sense also in families. Okay, that will be very important for the proofs. Anyway, you never use it except for the fact that it exists. Okay, and then you define D cross delta P1 as a set to be just a set of Z1, Z2 in D cross D, which match on ZP star, meaning that the restriction to ZP star of Z2 is equal to W delta of the restriction to ZP star of Z1. So exactly what we had for measures on P1 before. And then we have, we define the restriction map. So U now is an opaque compound subset of QP from D cross delta P1 to D cross U by the formula. So you have to think of Z1 as a restriction to Zp of Z, and you have to think of Z2 as a restriction to Zp of Wz. Okay. But how do you define this? Well, you define it as restriction U of Z to be the restriction to U intersected with Zp of Z1 plus HW times the restriction of to WU intersected with PZP of Z2. And here you are using the fact that P1 is the disjoint union of Zp with W of PZP. Okay, so if you look at what you are writing, it's just, I mean, just a traduction of the fact that you want this to be true. Okay, so the theorem is the following. Is that there exists a unique action of G on this space, D cross delta, a unique action of G, such that when you take the restriction to U of GZ, well, what you get is, so morally, the action of G is given by SG, HG, except that this HG is only defined on QP. It's not defined on all of P1. So you have to be a little bit careful. So that's why I write it in this way. So you take the restriction to G minus 1 U intersected with ZP of Z1 plus HGW, of the restriction to GW minus 1 intersected with PZP of Z2. Now, this is just because I stupidly divided my P1 into two copies of Z2, of ZP, and then, or in fact, no, I divided it into one copy of ZP and one copy of PZP, WPZP. And so this is such that HG is equal to G where it makes sense. And the proof is just a very painful computation, but not so difficult with these things. The only thing that is difficult is that you always have to be careful that if you meet infinity, you have to defy things.
As I understand, you first have C from P1, just from D, and then you can twist it by the line bundle O of 1 on P1 using your character in NF.
Yes.
So you can define multiplicative, and so.
Yeah, I'm not. I mean, the problem is that this delta is not very well behaved at infinity or zero, so.
No, we don't need, because if you have any lambda under on a one-dimensional periodic thing,
yeah,
you can use it, and a delta, you can use it to twist locally the section.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing, yes.
Two, and if you train section, you multiply by by delta of the ratio of the two sections.
Okay, so maybe I could make the computation in a nicer way. Well, in my papers, there are two pages of computations, maybe a little bit more, in fact. But maybe it's, well, I mean, for me, it was clear that it was going to work if you have this kind of formulas, but I still felt the need to verify it, but okay. maybe it's not so useful. Anyway, so it's you have this object now, and as I said, this object is not good in general. So you want a condition for it to be good. But before I give these conditions, and I am going to give you, I mean, to be even more perverse and insist on giving you the action of G with this decomposition here. So for this, I need a little bit of preparation. So if I have an open subset of QP, then I want to define a D cross U inside my thing. So I define an injection of D cross U inside D cross P1. And just by the following formula, so I mean it's the obvious formula. So iota U of Z is going to be, well, you take the restriction to U intersected with ZP of Z. So that's the first part. And then you take HW of the restriction to W ZP intersected with U of Z. And then you get you get this injection. And so you can verify very easily that the restriction of U composed with this inclusion is the identity. And when you go in the other direction, you get a projector. Eta of U with eta of U is a projector. And so the image of this projector, you call D cross U. Called image. And so now if you have any partition of P1, then you can write down any element here as a restriction, as a sum of the thing on the partition. So in particularly, if you have a Z in D cross P1, well, it can be written as Z equals Z. So this Z is Z1, Z2. And with this definition here, you can write it also as the restriction to Zp of Z, which is going to be Z1, plus W times the restriction to PZP of WZ. And it is also equal to the restriction to PZP of Z, which is also the restriction to PZP of Z1, plus W times the restriction to ZP of WZ, and this element is Z2. Okay, and so now you want to describe the action of G using this way of writing your element. And so it's quite ugly, but rather useful. So let me write the formulas. So it's useful because I want to point out one phenomenon. So what I call the skeleton of actions. I don't know how many t you put to skeleton. So you have your z, which is z1, z2, and you want to know what happens to it. So there are some things which are totally trivial. If you apply 0, 1, 1, 0 to z, what you get is z2, z1. And so z is z1, z2. The second thing is that if you apply the an element of the center, you get multiplication by the central character. Then you get delta of A, z1, delta of A, z2. So that's trivial. Now, if you take an element of the multiplicative group, so you have A, 0, 0, 1, and now you assume that A is in ZP star times Z, then what you get is by definition, so sigma A of Z1, that's the first thing, and the second one is delta of A times sigma A minus 1 of Z2, and this is just because when you compose 0, 0, 1 with this one, then the A comes back here, and so if you want to put it up, you have A minus 1 that comes out, and delta of A that comes out of the central character. Okay. The next thing is that if you have Z prime, which is P 0, 0, 1, Z, then what you get is that the restriction to P ZP of Z prime is equal to phi of Z1. And the restriction to ZP of W of Z prime is equal to delta of P times psi of Z1, of Z2, sorry. So same comment. This formula you obtain in the same way. And so if you know these two things, you know Z prime. And finally, so that's the formula which is complicated and which is false in the book because I don't know how to copy a formula. So if you take an element B in PZP and you take Z prime equals 1B01Z, then what you get is that the restriction to ZP of Z prime, well, this is just this. 1B01Z, meaning just multiplication by 1 plus t to the b. Z1. But the other one is a pain in the neck. So the restriction to PZP of WZ prime, then this is equal to UB. For certain operators UB that I'm going to define, the restriction to PZP of Z2. And this UB is given by the following formula. So it's delta of 1 plus B to the, yeah. So in the book, there is a minus 1 that should not be there. 1 minus 1, 0, 1. Then you compose with W of delta. Then you compose with, so there is another mistake in the book. 1 plus B to the square, minus 2, sorry. Here there is B, 1 plus B to the minus 1, 0, 1, W delta, and then 1 plus B, 0, 1. And so what does this UB do? UB is a map that goes from D cross PZP to D cross PZP. And so if you look at what happens, you go from D cross PZP then you go to D cross 1 plus PZP. Then when you apply W of delta, you stay in D cross 1 plus PZP. When you apply this one, you stay in D plus 1 plus PZP. When you apply W of delta, you still stay here. And when you apply this one, you go back. Okay. So what I want to point out is the following, is that as you can see from these formulas, the action of G is completely known if you know the structure of phi gamma module plus the W delta on D cross EP star. Okay, so that's the thing that which is important. And so you use it to prove the following kind of statements. So the corollary is the following. So assume that you have a submodule of D, which is stable by P plus. So P plus, I remind you, is Zp minus 0. Zp 0, 1, semigroup. And you want it to be stable by psi. And so that's the first thing. And if and such that when you look at the restriction, so M cross ZP star, which will be the image of M by the restriction to ZP star, is stable by W delta. Then M cross P1, which is just the set of Z1, Z2, such that Z1, Z2 are in M, this is stable by G. So this is how we are going to be able to study the locally analytic vectors of pi of D. So this is very useful for the descriptions. Of locally analytic vectors. Of pi of D. Okay. While I'm at it, also, I would like to point out that, I mean, here I put P1, but you could put anything on which G acts, basically. And so you could also do the same things not with GL2, but with GLN. In case you take several copies of D and you try it. I mean, what you have to do is find an object on which your group acts. And then you look at the formulas that you get for measures on this thing. Try to write the measures as measures on ZP by just taking a chart. And then I think that automatically you're going to get this kind of object with an action of any group. But I don't know what to do with the representation that you get. So I did not write the details, but I don't see why it would not work. Okay. So finally, before we actually try to suppress the anguish of having some kind of Langlands correspondence that brings everything to GL2, any dimension to GL2, there is one last thing which is extremely useful, which is the following theorem. But this one is very, very useful. So it's the fact that you can extend the pairing, which in a way which is G equivariant. So start from a decomposition of P1 in the following way. So it's a finite decomposition with open subsets, union, some union of Vj. So here I and j are finite. And you suppose the following thing, that infinity is not in ui, and zero does not belong to Vj for any j. And then you take an element x in d chesh cross delta minus 1 p1. You take y in d cross p1. And you define x, y on p1 by the formula that you would think. So it's going to be the sum of the I of oh, sorry, there is a delta here. Sum of I of the restriction of u I x restriction of u I y. So I told you that this pairing QP is basically localized. Okay, so you define the pairing on P1 as a sum of local pairing plus the sums over J. And now, I mean, one of them has to contain infinity of the restriction to W of Vj Wx restriction to W of Vj Wy Qp. So as I said, this pairing on Qp has the very nice property to be compatible, I mean, to be equivalent with the whole group of diffeomorphisms and so on. And so what you get is something which is independent of the decomposition, so is well defined. So in practice, what you take, you take here, you take Zp, and here you take the complement of Zp. But in the proof, it's better to have a flexibility. So this is well defined, so that's the first thing. And the second thing is that it is equivariant. So it's, well, it induces a perfect duality. It's just because OE is in perfect duality with itself, with the same thing. And then the surprising thing, at least for me, is that this is G equivariant. So GX, GY, P1 is equal to XY, P1 for all G in G. So this is very nice because you have a concrete description of the dual in terms of of the thing. And finally, I need to make some comparison between the construction I gave and the construction I gave last time. So last time I gave you some D cross QP. And so there is a map. Some restriction to QP map, which goes as follows. So if you take any element Z in D cross delta P1, you can associate to it the sequence of restriction to P ZP of P to the N 0, 0, 1, Z. And this is an element of D cross QP, almost by construction. And so you define this map restriction to QP.
So you get a map like this, and this is a P of QP equivariant. So it's equivariant for the mirabolic. And the thing which is important is that you don't lose so much information by taking the restriction map, because the kernel is very small. So if you look at what is the kernel of this restriction map, so it is things which are going to be equal to zero, for which the restriction of this thing is equal to zero for all n. And so you get that they are supported at infinity. So when you apply W to them, you get something which is supported at zero. And so in practice, it means that it is a set of things 0x, where x belongs to the intersection of the phi to the nd, which is what I call dnr. Okay? And I told you that this dnr is very small. It's so this dnr was some h0 of some group in V of d. And so it's a finite type over OL. And most of the time, it's torsion. And this is also equal, you can verify, it's also equal to the set of Z which are invariant by the action of the unipotent. So it's a set of Z which satisfy 1B, 0, 1Z is equal to Z for all Z in for all B in QP. And so it's somehow the dual of the Jacquet module. So it's dual of Jacquet module. So as I told you, this space is dual to, it's basically dual to D, you have to put a chesh here. It's dual to D sharp modulo D natural, dual. And I told you that this space is a little bit bothersome, but it plays exactly the role of the Jacquet module in the dual of the Jacquet module. Well, so one way is trivial is that if you have something that verifies that, then the restriction has to be zero, because the action of that is just multiplication by something which is invertible. It's multiplication by 1 plus t to the b. So so you have this, which is included in that, and the other way is quite easy. So. Okay. And so there is one thing that I have to add to this thing. So you have D cross U, which is a submodule of D cross P1 for any open compact subset. So you can embed a D cross QPC inside D cross delta P1 in a natural way, and in a GB equivariant way. Or let's say P of QP. I don't care about the central character. OK, so but something you cannot do is to split this REST QP map. So if you think in terms of P1 and QP, it's not true that you can that you can extend anything on QP to P1. There is some regularity condition at infinity. But at least if you have something that goes to zero at infinity, you should be able to extend it by zero at infinity. And that's exactly what happens. So you have the following lemma. So I remind you that something which goes to zero at infinity is d tilde. So if you take an element z in d tilde, which is d cross q QP PC, almost as super compact. Then what you prove is that the restriction to P minus N ZP Z has a limit in D cross P1, D cross delta P1. And so this gives you a natural embedding of D tilde inside this. So you can view D tilde injects into D cross delta P1. And what you get is equivariant for the action of the mirabolic and so on. Okay. And so now I can start serious business, I think. Should be able to start serious business. Ah, no, no, no. Before I start serious business, I have another lemma. So if you start from a Z in D tilde, and you assume that which is very small near zero. So by which I mean, if you take the restriction to P to the N ZP of Z, then this should go to zero periodically. So in particular, if you are in the torsion case, then this should be zero after some point, okay? Then what you get is that then W of Z, well, because this goes to zero near zero, W of Z goes to zero near infinity. So W of Z belongs to D tilde. So that's easy to prove, but it's useful to know. Okay, so now the problem is that we have an object which is clearly not good in general. So we have to find a decomposition of it. And so we have to find something that is going to play the role of measures on ZP. So there is a natural definition. So you define D natural. So assume first that D is torsion. You define D natural cross P1. And I don't put the delta. I don't put the delta. Okay. Well, no, maybe I put it, otherwise it will become a little bit complicated. You define it as a set of Z such that the restriction to QP of Z is in D natural cross QP. So you could use the same definition for D torsion free. But for D torsion free, you do something a little bit different. This thing will be called a D natural non-saturated equals the same thing. So non-saturated because it's not true that if you divide, I mean, it's not P saturated, meaning that you can very well have elements which are in this and which are divisible by P, and when you divide by P you get something which is not in this module. Okay? And so what you define, I mean, you define D natural cross delta P1 to be the saturation of this one. So it's a P saturation of G natural cross delta P1. And why can you have some things which are sometimes divisible but not in the module? It's always because of the existence of this small module here, D sharp modulo D natural. That's the thing that can create problems. It's a pain in the neck, but that's the way it is. Okay, so this one is really the projective limit of D mod P to the K D natural cross P1. And this one is a little bit bigger. Yeah, so what I should say is that, I mean, you're not getting something horrible. So if you take D natural cross P1 with the delta that I omit, modulo the non-saturated thing, NS, then this is finite length over OL. And in fact, it's a quotient, it's naturally a quotient of that thing over there. So, so it's not too big. So what do you have in there? So this D natural cross P1, this is inside D cross P1. And inside here, you have this D tilde, which is over there. And I told you that this one contains D tilde plus. So here you have D tilde plus here. And it's very useful to know that you have this subspace inside of here, because this one you can very easily use, I mean, describe using Figaro module. It's something that comes. I mean, something that can be read off of the Figama module very easily, contrarily to this thing, which is quite a nightmare. Okay. So now what is the problem? So as you see, by construction, this module here is stable by the mirabolic. Okay? Because it's the inverse limit of something of which you have an action of mirabolic by some map which is equivalent for the mirabolic. So by construction, D natural cross P1 is stable by the mirabolic by P of QP. So the question is whether it is stable by W or not. So question. And so this is not true in general, okay? And it is almost impossible to prove directly that it is. So the proof that it is in dimension 2 is extremely indirect. So, I mean, it was alluded to in Matthew's talk yesterday. So I will explain this probably next time, that you have to, so I mean, it will be true only in dimension 2, let's say, if it is reducible, that this space is stable. And the way the proof goes is that you have to produce sufficiently many D's for which you know it is true. And this will be the role of principal series or crystalline representations, crystalline D's. And then you argue by analytic continuation. So you argue by analytic continuation. So the space of D is the same as the space of Galois representations. And as Matthew explained yesterday, crystalline representations are dense in all of Zariski dense in all Galois representations, and that's how you prove it. It's a little bit a pain in the neck, but so now the question is, what can you say a priori if you know that it is stable by W? So assume it is stable by W. So So there are things that are true in that case and are not true in other case. Then the first thing you can show quite easily using a restriction to ZP and W is that this module D natural cross P1 is in fact compact.
Because it is going to be closed in a compact.
The very important thing, very useful thing, is that D natural cross P1, so the restriction to ZP QP map is surjective. So this is just because now you know this one is compact. The image is closed, and it's stable by P of QP. And I gave you a classification of possible subspace of these which are closed and stable by P of QP. Okay, so that's because image is closed and stable by P of QP. I don't know how to prove it without this fact. yeah, this is, sorry, it's delta. So there is something that you have to be aware of. So if you have an exact sequence 0, d1 goes to d, goes to d2, goes to 0. So if d natural cross p1 is stable, then it is true of d1 and true of d1 natural cross delta p1 and d2. The problem is that the converse is completely false. So converse false on in general.
Yeah.
So, yeah. It's for any delta in dimension one. Yeah, because you see, I mean, so how do you get reducible Galois representations? They are extension of things on dimension one. And so it's not here anymore. It's one case where it's going to be true. And so. But you see, so if you have something of dimension one, it is going to give you one character. And there is no way you can know about the other character, OK? And the other character is going to come by via this delta construction. So it's going to be the other, I mean, the delta is going to be the product or no, the quotient of the two. Converse in general, false. Okay. Yeah, and something that you have to know is that also this, so assume that this distortion then D natural cross delta P1 is stable by W if and only if there exists some open M inside D cross P1, which is open and closed, open and compact, compact open, which is stable. So if you can find anything which is sufficiently big that is stable, then automatically this one is also going to be stable. And that comes in the proof, what you are going to construct in some cases. It's a compact open subset of this one. OL module, sorry. M compact open. OL module. I mean, we are, I assume it is torsion here. So torsion is finite length, so compact open from a basis of neighborhood. In the torsion-free case, it's not true anymore. The topology on D cross P1, so it's induced by the topology on D cross D. Okay, so still assume that you are in the case where W stabilizes D natural cross P1, and then you have the very important result, which I find extremely surprising also, which is the following theorem. So D natural cross delta P1 stable by W, by G, if and only if the dual, I mean, the same thing for the dual holds is. But what is more important is a second statement, is that, in fact, the way you prove it is that, in that case, they are exact orthogonal of each other. So D natural cross delta P1 and D check natural cross delta minus 1 P1 are exact orthogonals.
This is assuming.
Yeah, yeah, this is always assuming that it's stable by W. Ah, yeah, okay, so sorry. Well, this is true, and if it is the case, are exact orthogonal. So it is surprising because I remind you that, in fact, if you look at D natural orthogonal, it's not D Cech natural that you get, but it's D Cech plus. So it's not a formal consequence. But basically, this follows almost from the fact that, well, I told you that you have d tilde plus, which injects inside d natural cross delta p1. So this d tilde plus is, in fact, dense when you go to d natural cross p cross qp. And so it's easy to see that the exact orthogonal of this one, that if you don't put P1, but if you put QP here, then the same thing with D Cech are going to be orthogonal and are basically going to be dense in the exact orthogonal. So you still have to fight with this small problem of at infinity, but that's not really a problem. It's a pain in the neck in the proof, but it does not cause any problem. Okay, so this is, I find it rather surprising, but it's extremely useful. Okay, so very useful. So in particular, there is one case where this is going to happen. So if you start from pi, well, let's say it's a torsion representation of G. Okay. Then I told you in my first talk that you can construct a D of pi out of it. Okay. So this is a phi gamma module now. So you can look at, and then you can look at D of pi natural cross delta, which is going to be the central character of pi, minus 1, I guess, because I took the dual, p1. This is going to be stable by g because it is exactly going to be isomorphic to pi dual. That's how you can prove that it is. So I mean, I'm going a little bit fast here. So what happens is that you have a map from pi dual. By construction, you have a map from pi dual to d natural, which is just the restriction to dt. That's the way this d of pi natural. So. And in fact, what you prove is that when you take restriction to Zp and the restriction of Zp apply to W, you land in this space, and this is an isomorphism. Okay, so that's way one way you can find some d for which this works, namely if you start from a representation of GL2 of Qp. And this tells you how you should construct your representation in general. So if d natural cross delta of pi is stable by g, by w, then you can look at pi of d, which is d cross delta pi modulo d natural cross delta pi. So you get something with an action of g. Or p, sorry, p1, p1. So you get something with an action of g. And now it has the right topological type, because you mod out by the thing that was the dual of something which is of compact type and which is something which is dual to Banach. So you're left with something which is a Banach, so let's say. Or Banach type. And so what do you get when you start from such a pi? So if d is d of pi, well, you get something which I call, so this pi of d of pi, I call pi chedge. And I view it as some kind of contragradient of pi. So it's a definition. It's not. It's a contragradient of pi. What? It's pi of d of pi. I told you here that this works for d of pi. This property is verified for d of pi with the right delta being of omega pi minus 1. And so maybe to give you some idea of what you get in this way. So what you can prove is that, there is one small caveat. So the small caveat is that the representation that you get in this way will never have finite quotient. They can have finite sub, but they can never have finite quotient. And so what you prove is the following, is that pi chesh is going to be isomorphic to pi if pi has no finite quotient. By finite, I mean finite length over OL. And it will be finite because OL is finite. And if it has a finite quotient, then this finite quotient just disappears. So the second thing, so I can tell you also what happens if you start from the irreducible representations that I listed before. So if pi is b of delta 1, delta 2, so it's this principal series representation, then this pi chesh is equal to b of delta 2, delta 1, so the one that corresponds, twisted by a character. Tensor omega pi minus 1. So the central character is the inverse, because there is a dual here. If you start from the Steinberg, then you have an exact sequence like this. You have 0, goes to the Steinberg is morally b of 1 omega, morally, I mean up to a finite quotient. And what you have is that you have an exact sequence of b omega 1. So the central character of the Steinberg is trivial. No, sorry, 0, 0, 0. Yes, it's bigger than what you would expect. It's this way. Steinberg is smaller, but its contragradient is bigger. You get an. And finally, if you start from something which is supercuspidal, then pi chesh is just pi tensored with omega pi minus 1. So this looks a lot like the classical situation. This also looks a lot like the classical situation, because in the classical situation, these two representations would be isomorphic. But here they are not, and so you get. And so Matthew claims that this contragradient is some x.
It's an x3.
So what do you say?
It's x3 over OL double bracket.
OL double bracket GL2 ZP. Okay, so if I put KL, KL it's 3, okay. Well, okay, it's, well, in that case there are KL torsion. ZP of what with x3? With pi.
Well, rather it's x3 over that ring of pi with that.
Ah, x3 over that ring of pi with that. Okay, so I put the pi here. So if you want details of this, you have to ask Matthew, okay, not me. And Matthew is leaving right after the lunch, so.
Huh?
2:30, okay. Well, I think that my time is over, so maybe it's a good point to stop. So next time, I will explain to you how to prove that this space here is really invariant under G in the case of dimension 2. And as I say, you cannot prove it directly. At least I don't know how to prove it directly. So you have to use what Matthew mentioned in his talk.